So it's great to be here to celebrate 50 years of EMBL. It's a real landmark that it's 50 years since the lab was set up. And interestingly, it's also 50 years since I started working on protein structure. Exactly. So my life in science mirrors exactly kind of what's happened at EMBL. So I, of course, having retired, one gets asked to give lots of these talks about what you've done, etc. And for the first time, I think as scientists, we never look backwards. We always look forward. And it's been quite a shock to me to look back and think about the changes. And so I wanted to have an introductory slide, just giving a bit of a historical perspective, because I wanted us to think about what EMBL was like when it was set up 50 years ago. And if we think about it, the first protein sequence wasn't determined until 53. The first structures were 58 and 60 with myoglobin and, of course, our first director general, Kendrew. The first collection of protein sequences by Margaret Dayhoff was 65. And then following this, we had protein sequences and structure galore. We had lots and lots of structures. And of course, these structures were captured in the protein data bank, which was set up in 1971. So it was probably the first molecular structure database. And that's had a huge impact. For me, all of my research has been based around that collection of structures. And so since 71, we now not only have the worldwide PDB and we have our European part of it at EMBL, EBI, but we also have an electron microscopy data bank and a public image archive with all of the raw data in it. And this is critical, I think, for the way that we think about the field, the way the field has developed. So if we look, you all know this, and this applies, I could have drawn this for transcriptome data, for proteome data, all of the data has just gone up enormously. So now there are 270,000-odd protein structures in the PDB. Of those, EMBL has contributed, 1,631. That's not a bad tally, I don't think. That just shows, and every one of those structures has its own intricacies and its own contributions to understanding the biology. And obviously in a talk like this in 20 minutes, I'm not going to be able to cover anything like all of that. But I wanted to at least show one slide from the main protein structure groups. So Heidelberg, Thomas, who actually is speaking to get tomorrow, so I need to include this one, but he's very keen on the time-resolved crystallography to explore enzyme mechanisms, which of course I'm keen on as well, because I want to know about enzyme mechanisms. But it's amazing that we can follow this in crystals and we can follow the catalytic reactions. And this just shows an example. I asked Christoph Muller to give us the something that captured the Heidelberg contribution. And he felt that this structure of the light harvesting complex with its chlorophylls, etc., by Werner Kuhlbrandt, which was one of the first determined by cryo-EM, was a really important step in the development. And lastly, from Grenoble, Christina suggested that Stephen work over many, many years on the influenza polymerase was really critical output from EMBL Grenoble. And here you can see, this is just such an amazing system where you look at the transcription, the replication and the making the capsid all in one complex, but that complex rearranges itself during the thing. But you can ask Stephen for much more information on this than I can give you. But obviously, my work has been very much in looking at many structures, not looking at just one structure. And so I wanted to think about the way that protein structure bioinformatics has evolved, really since when I started, when we started getting structures. So in the beginning, I only had 20. There were only 20 structures in the PDB when I started. And so we had no idea what this world of protein structures looked like. Every new structure was a rush to see Nature or Science to see what it looked like, because we really didn't know what they were going to look like. And so there was a collection of a small number of people who were interested in some of the principles of protein structure and trying to understand it. And really the purpose of the next few slides is to show that in every step of the development of protein structure bioinformatics, EMBL has made a key contribution to that through the people who've been at EMBL. And so initially, we all started looking in great detail at various aspects of structure, things like what the histidines do, what the tyrosines do, etc. We started looking at the geometry and at secondary structures and the fact that helices were actually curved and not straight and things like that, all the details of structures. Here in Heidelberg, Chris Sander and Pat Argos, who I couldn't find a picture of, worked on different aspects of structural bioinformatics. Chris, with his team, developed DSSP for assigning secondary structure from a structure, and also some of his people, well, Alfonso was involved in covariance of close amino acids through evolution, which has been important subsequently in the AlphaFold work. Also, understanding from our collection of sequences that were so important for understanding the structures, Des and Toby worked on ClustalW, and obviously Toby has developed the ELM database of linear motifs, eukaryotic motifs. But I also wanted to mention Arthur Lesk and Anna Tramontano, who sadly isn't here today with us, who did an immunoglobulin structure analysis when they were here. And so as we got more and more structures, we understood more about this world of protein structures. And evolution was clearly important. I should say, as a physicist, evolution is not top of one's head about what happens. And coming to an understanding of the importance of evolution for me was quite a revelation. It only took me about 30 years, but I kind of made it in the end. But the conservation of a structure was pointed out by Cyrus Chothia and Arthur Lesk. The phylogeny has been worked out here in Heidelberg by Pear, and also Nick Goldman has spent a lot of his career developing the methods to do the phylogeny. Then the protein domain families were developed by people who are Alex and Rob, who are at EBI, and obviously Pear with the SMART database as well. And as we got all of these structures, you know, it got to the point where we had about 500. And this is quite overwhelming if you're trying to remember them all. And I also remember, not being a biologist, the discovery that cytochrome B5 and cytochrome C didn't look anything like each other was a real problem for me. And so we had to organize so that we could put them into groups. And that really was the start of us trying to do the fold classification, Kath and Scop. And you can see here, I want to put up this picture of Cyrus Chothia and Mertzin and Christine Arengo when we had a celebration of Kath and Scop at EBI. There was also a stage where, horror of horrors, the PDB had structures in that were proved to be wrong. They were wrong. Now, if you do protein crystallography properly, you never get the structures wrong. It's really self-consistent. And so this development of validation, we did ProCheck. Chris with Kurt Ryan did What If, and Roman Laskowski was responsible for the ProCheck. But this appreciation of the evolution and the conservation of structure was fundamental to the idea of homology modeling, where you can take a structure of a known protein and model one of its relatives. But obviously, and there were these several groups around the world had very good homology modeling packages. But actually, in about the 2000s, the attention moved to protein-protein interactions, captured in string by pair, but worked on by many people, including us. And at this point, I thought, gosh, this function of these proteins is really quite important. We ought to look at it. So we started to explore not just what the structure looked like, but what they did. And that was clearly helped by the Go annotation, which are used across biology now, of which Michael Ashburner, who was director at EBI, was a key component of developing that Go annotation. And now we've already talked a little bit about dynamics, but the idea of going from structure to function became really important, and also the impact of post-translational modifications that Pedro and Evangelia have worked on. But actually, all this knowledge that was captured in the worldwide PDB was the basis of AlphaFold and the ability to predict three-dimensional structure from amino acid sequence. And this is captured in the AlphaFold database that was released in 2021. Seems like yesterday now, but it's some time ago. And basically now we have 214 million structures predicted. This is quite mind-blowing. Remember, I just had 20. We now have 214 million structures to look at. I mean, this is quite a challenge for everybody, I think. But what's important, I think, is that this, because of setting up the AlphaFold database and deep working with DeepMind, making these structures available, that means that every biologist who is working on a protein can now look to see if there is a good prediction of the structure of that protein. And obviously, it's been used very widely. But structures, although they are incredibly beautiful, incredibly detailed, actually, the reason we've determined so many is because they allow us to make new discoveries. And obviously, at a very simple level, one of the main things is to, with a structure, to use that structure to look at the biological context. So when there are ligand binding sites, if there are variants that cause differences, and this is the SARS spike glycoprotein, or the different multimeric states and the different interaction surfaces. So though that provides a basis for interpreting other data that is relevant to biological function. But there's been a lot of, since all these AlphaFold predictions, many people have worked on different aspects, and this just shows some of them. These mainly are not at EMBL, but so people have predicted multiple conformational states, trying to look at the energy surface, not the energy surface, but using AlphaFold to look at that, comparing and clustering structures at scale. I'll come on to that in a bit more detail. Predicting protein-protein interactions. So using this data, and of course now there's AlphaFold Multimer, that allows us, that predicts the multimeric state quite effectively. And there's also AlphaFold 3 that predicts the binding of a ligand that is not yet freely available to everybody. It's limited, but clearly it has improved our ability to predict those complexes and to predict the pose of the ligands. And this is critical for drug design, et cetera. And so I do hope this ultimately will become more widely available. But there's also the fact that with the metagenome sequence data, microbiome, et cetera, there are now 2.5 billion protein sequences in MAGNIFY. And apparently, in the next 6 months, Rob Finn is expecting another billion sequences to be deposited and a billion in the following month. So our world of protein structures has just exploded. And now we all the things that we did way back, we can revisit, but with all these billions of structures. So this has really sort of changed things. And of course, since about 1990, my interest was trying to understand function and relate it structures to function. And the first thing we did, because I thought, well, perhaps the fold determines the function. Absolute rubbish. It doesn't at all. The fold is just, well, it's just there. But we know, well, how can I say? We know there's an evolutionary relationship. So if proteins are homologs, they can have a different function or a different structure, or they can have the same structure, the same function. So, and this just shows, this is red is alpha, green is beta, and yellow is alpha beta folds. And it just shows for the different types of enzyme, oxidoreductases, transferases, hydrolases, et cetera. It shows how each of these have both alpha proteins, beta proteins, and alpha beta proteins. So the fold in itself doesn't determine the function at all. But of course, because of homology, often you can use the fold to predict what the function might be if they're very similar. So it's an interesting sort of step. And the last talk on the evolution of shape reminded me very much of the same sort of stuff for protein structures, where you're looking at the shape of them. It's not the overall shape, it's the details of that shape. And so we've been looking at enzymes. This is just a little bit on my stuff. Because the problem is when you've got all these homologs, and there are some families of enzymes that have been enormously expanded. The problem is these wretched relatives do different things. So they have different functions, because the evolution of function is obviously the major way that you evolve new enzymes with new functions. And so just saying, oh, this is a homolog of this one, it tells you it might be an oxidoreductase, but it doesn't tell you what the substrate is, or it doesn't tell you what the reaction is. In a general analysis of a lot of families, we were just interested in the general picture. And we found that most often during evolution, enzymes just change their substrates. It's easy to change the substrate a little bit, the small molecule. Changing the chemistry is actually much more difficult. And we only found in this case 1 in 10. I suspect it's actually less than that, that overall, that you usually retain, you don't change the chemistry of the reaction. In addition, so I thought, again, I've thought so many things where I've got it wrong. I thought that perhaps oxidoreductases would, during evolution, become transferases, because it's kind of one step farther. Or they would prefer, which they became, if you look at this plot, this captures how often you get an oxidoreductase, the red ones, changing into a hydrolase, a transferase, a hydrolase, a lyase, etc. What you can see is that all these are connected, i.e. there in the data, there are examples where every sort of enzyme is converted to a different sort of enzyme, which is, again, quite surprising to me. And I think actually this needs more work, but it's quite a lot to look at all these different examples. In addition, we've captured these active site templates, because it's okay saying, oh, the fold of the protein is the same, but actually the bit that does the catalysis most often is the best conserved bit in the whole protein. We know that when proteins evolve, they keep their cores and they just put these variations or decorations on the surface. So that central core, you can capture as these active site templates. And in fact, we developed templates some time ago when we only had about 100,000 proteins, capturing catalytic residues, ligand binding residues, and DNA and whatnot. And you can use these not just to look at the fold, but also to look at the details of that active site. And in fact, this is a very preliminary search on using some of these templates to search through the very first release of AlphaFold on the human one. So this was a small search. But it means if you're trying to assign functions, you don't just want to look at the fold and the homology, you need to go in and look at the active site, catalytic site. And we've also been most recently trying to predict reaction mechanisms, not using QMMM, but using a sort of bioinformatics approach where we use all the knowledge that we have of enzyme mechanisms and we feed that in to create rules that can then be applied to a new structure, a new enzyme. And that works okay. It's got to be improved, but it does seem to me to be a good way forward. However, for me, having started, imagine I started out with my 20 structures clustered together. You know, we had the alphas and the betas, and then Tim came along and that was an alpha beta and whatnot. And you could have this overview of the world of protein structures. So this is just the same as looking at flowers or plants and trying to cluster them. It's the same human instinct to create order out of chaos. So I wanted these last few slides. To me, are the most exciting thing about, it's not my work, it's from Christina Rengo and David Jones's lab. And what they've done is to analyze the 214 million protein structures that are in AlphaFold to see what comes out. So they've built using, this is based on Kath, all the work that we've done over many years to analyze protein domain structures. And they've done this, but they've had to create new tools because 214 million structures with their XYZ coordinates for every atom is quite a lot of data. So processing this demands a huge amount of compute, actually. So they've done that and they've created TED. Now, this is still just in bioarchive. It's not published yet. And it's the Encyclopedia of Domains. But I just wanted, so what they've done, they've taken the 214 million structures from the AFDB, from the database. They've then, first thing you have to do is identify the domains, which is what they've done. And they found most of them can be matched to things that to folds we already knew, to structures that we already knew. But they found about 7,500 new folds, which is quite interesting. So these show some of the new folds, and you can see there a whole variety of different things. They're hard to, well, it's just hard to get your head around all of this. But I just wanted to show you this, which is new symmetric folds, which are different. And what you can see here, if we look at the top, we actually have a WD-40 repeater propeller, but with 11-fold symmetry instead of the usual 8-fold symmetry. It's just added in another domain. And you've got things like this and these. These are folds that we haven't seen before. I mean, it's really interesting to know if, and obviously to test this using experimental methods to make sure this is what they actually look like, would be really exciting. And this lot at the bottom, oh no, I've not got them, dash. It's in the paper. They've got things that they call extruded domains, where basically you take your protein shoelace and you just wrap it round and round. So we've already got some of those. We've got the beta sheet ones, but they've now got different ones, and they call those extruded domain because they progress along, and they're quite fascinating structures. So this is thanks to Christine and David for letting me have the slides. The other thing that's really important is that some of these families are really highly expanded, as I explained before, where they change their functions. But you see thousands of sequences that recur. And so knowing, and this just shows the frequency. So the topoisomerase domain 2 is really, there are over 50,000 sequences with that fold. So you can go around and classify them like that. So to me, this is just amazing, because we have now a much broader view of this. Of course, we have to check and see whether some of these structures are correct, but most of them, to my mind anyway, over the last 2 years since AlphaFold came out, in general, the predictions have been good. There are problems, of course, there are problems, but in general, they've been good. So where do we go for the future? So this shows what I haven't mentioned, and I think Jan Kaczynski is going to talk. Is that right? Is Jan speaking? Sorry? Oh, in the discussion, yeah. So where are we going? I mean, clearly, these proteins are just the components of life, and they work together to do lots of different processes. And we've heard this morning and this afternoon about the structure of the brain and all these things, and these are all through proteins. And so we need to understand from the molecular to the cellular and try and go more broadly from that. I'd also like to make a plug for bioinformatics. I know this isn't the bioinformatics session, but it does seem to me that this is where we are. This is what our indicative scheme is, going from the molecular to ecology and beyond. And I think of these different data types, as being like bits of a bridge that haven't been joined up yet. And what we have to do is to join up the different data and the different understanding and knowledge that we have. And I can't see any other way to do it than by using computational methods, basically. And so, of course, this is my world, you understand. My world focuses around protein sequences and structures. But of course, there are many other worlds around us, some of them transcriptomes, cell atlases, genomes, of course, pathways, functions. But there are these huge areas of data, the medical data, the biodiversity data, and the chemical data. And so bringing all of this together, I think, well, it can only be done computationally. So I'd like to thank the people here in my group, but also Christine and David for letting me show those slides. I'd like to thank my group members over so many years that have been so much fun to work with. I'd also like to thank my structural biology colleagues here in EMBL. It really has been a pleasure for me over the last 20 odd years to work together with them. And I think we're very lucky that that EMBL is a centre for this. And lastly, of course, everybody at EMBL-EBI. Thank you.